birds, many mammals, some fish and of course social insects spend some or all their life in social groups. In the majority of cases, the main role of sociality is reproduction. In some animals, it has additional roles like protection from predation as well as obtaining food. Social structures serve the reproductive strategy of both sexes. They are shaped by the competition between males, between females, and by the inherent conflict between females and males. In many species, they serve rearing of offspring and parental care. Animal sociality is fascinating and highly variable, as we will see, for example, in apes, where closely related species that share 99% of their DNA sequence have totally different social organizations. The simplest manner to classify animal social organizations is by evaluating the number and relations between males and females. Traditionally, our society is based on families with a female and a male with their children, a structure called monogamy. Monogamy is prevalent mainly in animals in which both parents take care of their offspring. It is most prevalent in birds. To nest, incubate eggs, and feed young ones, two parents are better than one. We are here on the southern shores of Lake Kinneret, observing huge nesting colonies of ibises, cormorants, and egrets. In these species, both parents raise the young together, like we see here in these cattle egrets. Incubation requires two parents that take turns sitting on the eggs, or one that sits, usually the female, and the second, usually the male, that provides the food. Two parents are also more efficient providing food and feeding the young ones. And this pattern is so widespread in birds, it appears to be a successful partnership. Here, we see lovely Atlantic puffins we filmed in Iceland. Puffins are long-lived and nest in burrows on cliffs. After spending the winter at sea, they return year after year in spring to the same burrow where they meet the same mate. Until recently, most birds were considered completely monogamous. However, once genetic testing was introduced, a very different picture unfolded. It appears that most species that were analyzed were found to be promiscuous. Males and females do not mate only with their nesting partners, but also with other males and females. Many nests are inhabited by young ones with different fathers, and males thus often take care of offspring not sired by them. This behavior is called social monogamy. Bateman was wrong. Bird females are not content with a single male, and the fact that this behavior is so widespread suggests that they have good reason. Among these reasons that remain obscure could be achieving genetic variability, obtaining good genes from successful males, obtaining compatible genes, and other genetic and non-genetic advantages. While most birds breed in pairs, some demonstrate fascinating different breeding strategies. In most of these, the only role of the male is to mate with a female. In some of these birds, the males gather in so-called leks, where they compete in trying to impress females that come to find a mate. After mating, the female leaves to build a nest, lay eggs, incubate them, and take care of the young ones all on her own. We see here a corybuster, the largest flying African bird that is using leks to find a mate. An interesting aspect of these leks is that a small number of males in the lek succeeds in mating with most of the females, while the rest hardly mate at all. It remains unclear how females choose. Is it by the look of the male or the display he puts together, as we have seen in the sexual selection video? Some suggest that females are influenced by watching other females and imitate them so that the way to popularity, even if randomly started, is short. There is nothing as successful as success itself. In cuckoos, like this class cuckoo we spotted in Malawi, not only the males but also the females avoid taking care of the offspring. They lay their eggs in nests of unsuspecting other birds that incubate and feed their young ones. This behavior is called brood parasitism. In most cases, the size and pattern of the egg of the parasite evolves to be very similar to that of the host. The parasite sometimes removes the host egg from the nest so the host won't discover the unwelcome addition. In this amusing video shot by Dr. Eshel Ophir, we can see a great spotted cuckoo fledgling raised by hooded crows. It is already pretty big but still begs for food from his foster parents. this parent doesn't care and just comes to dip the bread he found in the water. We'll conclude this video about bird reproduction by visiting barn owl nesting boxes with Dr. Yoav Motor from the Israeli Ministry of Agriculture.
The barn owls we're seeing are utilized for biological control of rodents. And the idea is to use wild barn owls. We don't bring them in, they just come by themselves. What owls don't do, and that we supply them, is they don't build a nest. They're secondary cavity nesters. That means they nest in cavities that they do not build. Woodpeckers, for instance, nest in cavities that they do build. Barn owls have to find something ready-made because there's not much of that readily available in agriculture. We supply them with that. And we supply them and we use that for focusing the hunting where we want it. So we build houses that are fit exactly for what they like, and we put them exactly where we want. We use another trait of the owls. They have, they're fit for variable rodent populations. In some years, we have very high rodent populations in the fields. In some years, they're rather low. This year, they're rather low. And in those years, the owls lay less eggs. In years like these, 3-4 eggs. In high years, like say 2 years ago, same nests 2 years ago, 11 eggs, and almost all of them fledge. Why is that? Because the population grows. So they do some sort of family planning to the amount of rodents. They do another thing. No bird lays all their eggs at once. They lay an egg in every 2 days, maybe 1.5 days. And if you look at a chicken or at a sparrow or other passerine, they lay their eggs, lay an egg. And once they've laid their last egg, only then they start incubating. That means that the embryo inside the egg starts developing only when they start incubating, and eventually all would hatch pretty much the same day. If you look at chicks of chickens, they all look as if they were laid on the same day. It's not the case, but they all hatch the same day. Barn owls don't do that. Barn owls have non-synchronized hatching. That means that the female lays the eggs every 1 or 2 days and broods them from the beginning. That means that the first that would hatch is the first that was laid, and that would be 2 weeks ahead of the last one. It's a really big difference. By the time the last one will hatch, the first one will weigh more than its parents. This is good because you cannot really expect the rodent populations. If you have a lot, then all of the brood will survive and fledge. If you do not have enough, it's going to be obvious who would survive and who would not. The big ones would, the small ones would not. By the way, the ones who do not are fed to their brothers, which is rather shocking, but that's nature. If the rodent population is really high, they do another thing. The female, who obviously laid the eggs, and not obviously, was the only one brooding them. In many species, both sexes share the brooding. In barn owls, only the females. The females who are with the eggs and with the young that have just hatched, once the young can stay for themselves, the male, who has been bringing food all along, stays with them, and the female leaves to make a new nest with a new male. So they can fit another clutch in the same seasons. All these traits help us reduce the amount of rodents in the fields. And if you look at it from an agricultural point of view, it actually solves the rodent problem. If you look at it from an environmental point of view, it solves the rodent problems, giving us a natural solution. We're able to reduce the amount of poison that we use in those fields. In general, we reduced the amount of poison used in Israel in total against rodents by more than a half. In specific fields, it's more than 90% reduction of the poison that's needed. And I think that's wonderful.